Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 10 of the Jenerosity Show. I'm your host, Jennifer Evans, connecting you to extraordinary people and organizations that are making a huge impact around the world. We also talk about important issues like mental health, addiction, trauma, and on today's show, human trafficking. And the reason why these things are so important is because, you know, so many of these humanitarians too, they just didn't one day say, you know what, I'm going to go out and do this because, you know, I just want to help those people. A lot of times it's because it's something that has actually impacted their life and brought them a lot of pain. And they've figured out how to turn that pain into purpose to really help people around the world. So thank you so much for tuning in. I am so excited about today's guest. Her name is Chong Kim, and she is a renowned speaker and advocate for human trafficking, as well as a television, film, and TV producer. So I'm so excited about having her on the show today. Before we get started, I just want to welcome everyone who's watching. Hey, Jennifer, George, David. I want to say hello to my grandmother, Coco, because she's so cute. This week, she actually told me that sometimes when it gets bored or lonely, that she'll watch reruns of my episode to hear my voice because she feels like she's with me. So that's really, really cute. I love you, Grandma. I want to just start off by saying, you know, what's the most generous thing that's happened to me this week? So I was actually leaving a parking garage, and my car was making a noise as I turned the steering wheel. And the guy that was the attendant said, you know what, I think that you might need to put some power steering in your car. And I was like, you know what, I actually have some in my trunk, but I don't know how to do it. You know, usually my dad would help me with my car, but I'm in California, he's in Arizona. So he's like, why don't you flip around and come back in and I'll do it for you. So that was just so cool. His name's Roberto over at Viacom. Just want to give a shout out to him. He made my day. And, you know, that's how the world goes round. And, you know, at the end, he goes, you know what, I want to be a pastor and I'm a Christian. And I was like, you know what, here's the cross. I'm a Christian too. And it was just really sweet. You know, there's people of all faiths that are kind, but I just knew that, like, thank you, Lord. I needed that and he saved me. So that's great. So next up, I don't want to wait any longer. I want to jump into our guest because we have a lot to talk about. You know, her and I, you know, actually met. It was a cool story how we met. We met in Dallas, Texas in 2017. And I was at an event called the Habitude Warrior Conference that Eric Swanson puts on. It's all these great speakers that come together and inspire. So we were at the VIP lunch, sitting around a table, and Eric always just randomly calls on people and says, hey, you know, Greg Reed, can you tell us something? Bill Walsh, you know, give us something. And, you know, Chong actually just happened to walk in the room, and, you know, we were in the middle of this lunch and nobody knew her. And we were like, and Eric said, hey, who are you? Tell us about yourself. And Chong was just like, it was like she was on stage and she knew she was walking into it. And she told her story and all of us just were like, wow. And he loved it so much as he said, I want you to be on the stage. I think it was the next day that she spoke on stage. So we became fast friends. And, you know, so I'm just honored that she's on the show because she's really an inspiration. She's very resilient. And I think about the things I've been through and it's nothing compared to her. And she, you know, just pushes on, you know. And so, you know, Chong Kim, she's a renowned world speaker and activist. She's appeared on notable talk media shows like BBC, The Huffington Post, CNN, CNBC, Montel, and much more. Chong is also a writer and film TV producer. Her film, which was loosely based on her experience, Eden, was released in 2012, along with her memoir, Broken Silence. Currently, Ms. Kim is in works to launch a scripted TV series about human trafficking called Every 40 Seconds, which is about a female survivor of human trafficking who works alongside the FBI to teach them how to link the trafficker in order to rescue the victims in time. That seems pretty cool. Actually, Chong asked me to be involved earlier this week, so I'm really excited. It's such a great cause. So while Ms. Kim continues to educate the public about the harms of exploitation and child trafficking, which we're going to discuss today, she enjoys her time writing poetry, singing, and traveling. So without further ado, I'm going to welcome Chong to the show. Hello, how are you? Hi. Welcome. How's your day going?
Good, really good.
Awesome. Well, I would just love, you know, if you want to start off by telling us why you're so passionate about human trafficking. And I guess it starts with your story, right?
Yes. Just to give everyone an insight, I actually grew up with child sexual abuse. My first rape happened at 3 years old, and it continued till I was six. But then after that, I was sexually molested and abused all the way up till I was 9 or 10. And growing up, no one said anything. No one, even when I spoke out, no one listened to me because they saw me as a child, don't make things up, be quiet, you know, that sort of thing. But I was also, I don't want to get too much about my history, but I also grew up with domestic violence. Mm-hmm. I grew up with abuse. And I also grew up with abuse even in school. So I didn't have an outlet. By the time I was 18, I wanted to become a police officer. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, you know, grow into the law enforcement sector and wanted to become a an attorney because I wanted to fight for children's rights. Mm-hmm. And so, but when I was around 18 or 19, I met a guy that I thought was a Marine. And he was wearing a military Marine uniform, but I didn't realize he bought it from an Army surplus store. Mm. And that was, you know, before I was 18, I was in foster care, but I didn't use. I wasn't on drugs. I wasn't pregnant. I wasn't incarcerated because I wanted to keep myself clean. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to really save myself, regardless of the rape and abuse that I went through. I wanted to save myself for someone who actually would value me and love me.
Wow.
And so by the time I was 18, I was actually raped when I went with a friend by a cab driver. And after that, everything just kind of downward spiraled from there. And about a year after the rape, that's when I met the recruiter. And I was making my way from Oklahoma. I grew up in Oklahoma. And I was making my way from Oklahoma to Dallas, Texas. Mm-hmm. Because for those of you who don't know, us Okies, we have Dallas, Texas as a separate state. To us, it's like Manhattan.
Okay.
Who's going to go to Manhattan? Who's going to go there? And so, but that's how I met the recruiter. And I didn't know anything about red flags because I grew up with abuse. I didn't know what boundaries were, what was healthy, what was not healthy. Mm-hmm. And so, the first time the guy ever said I was beautiful, I fell in love with him. He said, "You're beautiful. I want to be with you. I want to take care of you." And I was like, yay, without really knowing anything about him. Because I was really thirsty for someone to love me and accept me. And so from that point on, we were in Dallas. We were supposed to go to Florida, but I ended up in northern Nevada on the Indian reservation.
Wow.
There was me and a group of girls that were held in each storage unit.
Really?
Yes. If you see the movie Eden, and it's actually available on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
For those who have Amazon Prime, it's free. And it's called Eden with Beau Bridges and Jamie Chung. Even though it is loosely based on my story, but one of the things I want to show people, the storage unit is real. When we stayed there, but I was solicited, even though I was 19 years old, I was still solicited to customers that I was a 13-year-old Japanese girl. So
wow.
Just imagine all these monsters that were buying us children were thinking that they were paying for rape on a 13-year-old Japanese girl. And so throughout all of that, I mean, I went through moments where I was angry. I went through moments where I even said, "I hate you, Bob.
Mm-hmm.
Why would you do this? You're disgusting. You're allowing this to happen." That went through my mind. And I remember one time we were lined up, and this is probably, the timeline is really hard to pinpoint when you're being trafficked. And mm-hmm. I want to make that clear because there's been a lot of people asking different questions, but not directly to me, about why my timeline is off. When you're being drug induced, you're being beaten, you don't have any way of having a sense of time. Mm-hmm. You know, outside, you can't see if it's nighttime or morning. You don't know what time it is. It can really destroy your sense of timing. And so, and it happens a lot with people with PTSD, complex PTSD, and especially with drug-induced, it causes dementia, paranoid, and all other type of symptoms. So please be understanding when survivors are sharing their story and it doesn't make sense, because it's not logic. Let's remember that. It is not logic. To being abused is not logic. So you can't think with a logic mind what he or she is trying to convey.
That makes a lot of sense.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And so, because, I mean, there are times, you know, when I went through this, I didn't know what time it was. I didn't know if I ate yet. I couldn't remember if I ate breakfast or not. I couldn't remember what was my last meal because I was so depressed. I was drug-induced and everything. But anyway, to get to the point that I went to get to, I remember crying and I said, I hate you, God. I don't want to have anything to do with you. If I die because they killed me, because I remember growing up in church and I was told that you could die and you could go to the fires of hell. In my mind, I'm thinking, you know what? I don't care anymore. I don't care that I will go to the fires of hell. It's better than being here and having to witness children being raped and sodomized right in front of you. And so I said, I don't care. Next thing I knew, I remember that one of the traffickers grabbed the door for the warehouse doors and he rolled it open. And I remember this blue butterfly landed on my finger. And I remember the wings. And I felt like a three-year-old child. Have you ever seen toddlers get enamored over the simplest things? And so what happens is, when I was touching the wings, I remember hearing God say to me, everything is going to be okay.
Wow.
I didn't know it was God. I didn't believe it. There were times I thought maybe I was hallucinating. You know, it really wasn't him. Somebody was whispering something to me. And so, but from that point on, that gave me the strategy in my mind how to break free. Even if that meant that I had to rank up to be a madam in order to get out. And so, in 1997 is when I escaped. And people will have to read the book to get the details.
Okay.
Sorry, I escaped on that one.
Nice one. Well, we're going to have to talk after the show because I want to know. No,
exactly.
No, I'll read the book.
Okay. I will send you a free book.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. And but the hardest part about recovering from trafficking was the aftermath. It wasn't so much duration of the trafficking, because after a while, your brain becomes a robot. You're waiting for that next, what to do, what not to do. You know, you're waiting for that snap finger. You wake up, it's kind of like a regimen you're used to. You're used to the trafficker saying, okay, you come with me. The other girls stay. You follow orders. You go into a truck. You go meet the clients. Then you come back. Then you shower. You do what you need to do. So I remember someone asked me, they said, the first time you were free, you were happy. And I said, no, I wasn't. I was scared. I almost wanted to call my trafficker to come pick me up.
Wow, yeah.
That's how bad it was. Because I was left with nothing. I didn't have a home. I didn't know who to call to. And when people ask me questions like, well, why didn't you call your mom? You have to remember, a lot of survivors, and I'm not saying all, but a lot of survivors do not have that healthy home upbringing. Mm-hmm. We can't call our family. And even if we did, even if we came from a good, healthy home, what do you tell your mom, dad? The worst news? Mom, I'm not this precious little girl that you thought. I have been raped and sodomized. I had men that go to church with us, men that we voted for, men that we, you know, uphold and admire, that paid to rape me. Do you tell that to your parents? You know, and the other thing is, I wrote this in my poem a long time ago. I said, I didn't like the word survivor anymore, because I felt like when people look at me, they either see that I'm either strong or debilitated. It's never just one meaning. So if you notice on my hashtag, I always say overcomer trendsetter.
Overcomer trendsetter. Okay, I like that. I'll remember that.
Because I feel like that survivors are more than just surviving. We have overcame unsurmountable pain.
Yes.
And everything that we've gone through. And so fast forward to 1997, after I got out, I didn't know what to do. And so I ended up, you know, working on the street. And so people said, so you went into prostitution? Yes, for survival. Mm. It wasn't something that I wanted to do. It was all I knew. And the other thing was, I wasn't born here. I was naturalized at the age of 8. I got to shake Ronald Reagan's hand when I was 8 years old. But the trafficker destroyed my documents. And with those documents, I couldn't get housing. I couldn't get welfare. I couldn't get any of those things. And so I was basically, you know, not able to get the resources that girls can get today. And so that's the other reason why I continued the life on the street. And I will admit, there was a part of me, I was angry. I went through a phase where I was angry. I said, you know what? If I'm going to be abused, then I will control it. Yep. I want to pick the men that gets to have me and who doesn't. And the ones that get to have me, I fought back. I stole credit cards. I did everything I could because I felt justified. I was angry. Mm-hmm. And I had so much hurt and anger. Until I met 3 Christian college students. I didn't know anything about a healthy relationship. And they, one of the guys, it started with one guy, and he approached me, and he said he wanted to help me. Mm. And I thought something was wrong with him. I said, are you gay? You know, what's wrong with you? You know? Yeah. I was so used to men that once I said, oh, I'm a prostitute. Mm-hmm. And I was not shy back then. Mm-hmm. And they would say, oh, they would either rape me or they would kick me out of their car. So when I told this one Christian guy, I said, I'm a prostitute, I remember feeling the brakes. And I thought, here we go again. He's going to either throw me out or he's going to rape me. And he said, I'm going to take you to church. And I was like, oh, even better, I'll get Bible thumped. That's what I thought. And so from that point on, I remember the student, because it was a Christian college campus, and I remember even the students that were friends with these guys, they embraced me. Mm. They're like, hi, my name is so-and-so. I want to be your friend. And I thought, why? What do you want? Mm-hmm. My money? What's going on here? You know, I was the one that was paranoid. And I remember one of the Christian guys, he said, because I was asleep, and he said, do you think she'll steal our Rich Mullins tapes or CDs? And I woke up and I was like, is he Tupac? Is he Mac-10? Does he rap? And they're like, what? No. It's a Christian music. And I was like, forget it. I'm not stealing those.
Oh, that's good.
And there was a lot more details in the book, and it's actually hilarious. But after a while, you know, that meant a lot to me, that even when I ran away from them, even when I was relapsing back into drugs, and I remember MCI, the collect call. MCI, you have a collect call from Chong Kim. They always accepted it.
Wow.
They said, Chong, come home. They kept saying, they said, come home.
Wow.
But at that time, I didn't have the appreciation, because all I kept thinking about was, when's my next fix? I was already drug addicted. I was into cocaine, crack cocaine, meth, you know, I was willing to do anything and everything for that next fix. Because like I said, the aftermath of the trafficking is the hardest part, because you have to really deal with those feelings, and it is really, really painful, you know. And so fast forward to 2003, I'm jumping all over the place, so I apologize.
Oh, it's great. It's perfect.
So I actually volunteered. I had 2 years clean during that time, about 2 to 3 years clean. And I started volunteering in Minnesota as an advocate for battered women. And I was actually working in the court system because mm-hmm. I wanted to be a lawyer. I wanted to learn everything. I would spend hours and hours at the law library learning every statute I could think of. And so then one day I remember my supervisor, she said, we're not going to go to court today. Because we were known as legal advocates, meaning we were the advocates that would sit with the battered victim and hold her hand through the whole court system. Mm-hmm. We were the ones that took them home. We were the ones that brought them to the court. We wanted to make sure they were safe so the batterer would not follow them around. We actually put our lives at risk. And so I remember one day my supervisor said, we're going to learn about human trafficking. So I'm thinking, well, are men throwing women out of the cars or something now? You know, I didn't know what it was. You know, and I was like, what's going on here? Or are we loading up, you know, are we getting traffic tickets? You know, are we taking in traffic ticket cases? You know, and I remember being at the U of M. And, I mean, the crowd was packed. They had three women that were from Washington, D.C., and they were educating people about human trafficking. Mm-hmm. And I remember I'm bawling my eyes out. I mean, I kid you not. It's like that ugly cry that you go, yeah. You're like, I don't want any selfies because this is the ugly cry. And I remember one of my coworkers looked at me and she's like, are you okay? I know it's a sad story because the woman was sharing her story. And it was very similar. She was handcuffed. She wasn't allowed to go anywhere. She was shackled. She was beaten. She was held against her will until a college student raised her hand and the three ladies, they said yes. And the college student says, well, can it happen to American women? And they said, absolutely not. And I stood up and I was like, I'm sorry, but I said, I'm sorry, but I disagree with you. And the lady looked at me and she goes, who are you and what's your expertise? And I said, it happened to me. Now, knowing I said, I'm an American survivor, guess what they did? They called INS on me.
What is INS?
Immigration Naturalization Services.
No way.
But what was funny was when they contacted me, they said, we heard you're a victim of human trafficking. I was afraid I was going to get deported. I was like, I don't know anything about Korea. I came here as a toddler.
Yeah.
And so then they said, well, you might qualify for a visa. Not realizing what the visa they were talking about was a U.S. visa. I was thinking of a credit card. So I'm thinking, yes, I'm going to get reparation on my pain and suffering. So they took me to downtown. And I remember they said, okay, what country were you trafficked from? And I said, Dallas, Texas. No, no. What country? Dallas, Texas, USA? Did I forget the USA?
Yeah.
And they're like, no. What country? And I was like, I guess the one USA, it's a country. And in my mind, I started to feel dumb. Like, did I miss something in geography class?
Yeah.
But what was funny was they assumed that I was trafficked from another country into Dallas, Texas.
Okay, gotcha.
And that was the first time I learned that American women and girls did not have the same benefit as the foreign victims of trafficking.
Oh, okay.
So that's when I got angry and I started speaking out.
Okay.
And after that, the floodgates opened. I was on CNBC, Montel, CNN, BBC, and all those shows. And then I had a producer that says, I want to do a story about your life. Mm-hmm. And I said, sure, let's do it. I had no idea what was going to happen after that.
Mm-hmm.
And so...
So do you mind me asking you, how did you go through the healing process? Was it before was it while you started speaking out? Were you also getting therapy? I'm sure speaking about it helps, but you know, what else did you do to make sure you stayed clean and healed yourself?
In 2002, I was taking tons of antidepressant medication.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like a zombie because I felt very numb. I couldn't feel anything. I would hear really horrific cases and I didn't even shed a tear. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I feel heartless. What's going on here? Until one day I told my therapist, I said, I'm tired of these. And I remember I had like 8 different antidepressants. And he said to me, he said, what do you want to do? And I was literally spitting the pills at him. I said, none of these work. And I tossed everything. And I thought he was going to hit me. And he was like, Wow. You're taking control of your therapy. So wow. He asked me, he said, what do you want to do? And I said, I don't want medication to fix me. Teach me, what are the skills that I need to learn? What is it that I need to do to retrain my brain that what I went through is not okay? And he said, what are you talking about? And he said, I have violent thoughts. I have nightmares. I have insomnia. I can't go to sleep. When I dream about blood and guts. I dream about wanting to kill these traffickers. And I kid you not, I mean, my dreams used to be extremely violent. That it would put these really bad, violent, you know, what's that movie? Kill Bill to shame. You know, but I was scared. I didn't care that the therapist kept saying, but that's normal. I don't want it to be normal. Mm-hmm. I don't want to normalize these thoughts because it's scaring me. Because I'm afraid that one day, the more people and therapists keep saying it's normal, I'm going to end up killing somebody that is a trafficker. Mm-hmm. And how people view me as that, you know? So I wanted accountability and responsibility. So they started introducing me to dialectic behavioral therapy.
Okay.
I love it. 12 steps did not work for me. And please, for those of you who love 12 steps, who feel that it worked for you, amen.
It worked for me. So I think everyone's different, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I just want to say for me, and I think it's because I was force-fed with drugs, I couldn't apply or comprehend the first step.
Yeah. You know?
And so DBT really helped me. And DBT actually taught me, like, the core mindfulness. They do 3 minutes of prayer. 3 minutes of meditation. So I apply it to prayer. I pray every morning. If I don't, my day goes crazy.
And you're like, me too.
And one of the things I always tell people, make sure you get 2 mentors. Get someone who's older and mm-hmm. someone who's younger. You'd be surprised what kids can be an amazing mentor.
Oh, I like that. I've never heard that.
Yes. I always pick, because one of my best friends, she has a daughter who's 12. Mm-hmm. And she actually helped me write some of the episodes. And she said, don't underestimate the character I created. Even though she's 8 years old, she's really smart. Got it. Because I think we do underestimate children mm-hmm. and how they think and how they rationalize things. And so I always say, get 2 mentors. Get someone who's older so that way they can share their experience, and get someone who's younger so that way they can remind you that life is full of possibilities and beautiness, so that way we can get out of our rut. And then now I have this message that I always tell people. If you're going through grief, depression, you're feeling sad, I only give you 72 hours for a pity party. Mm-hmm. Play whatever sad songs you want to play over and over. But after 72 hours, dust yourself off. Start writing goals. Every negative thought that I had, like, you're stupid, you're ugly, you're disabled, how can anybody want you? So what I did is I wrote all the list I say to myself that is negative. Then I fold it in half, long ways, and I write all the opposites. Then I write all the things, because that way I don't have to depend on someone else giving me that confirmation. That way I can say, I am beautiful. And because I'm disabled, I am amazing. Mm-hmm. And because I didn't give up and all these amazing things, I'm a strong person because of all these things. And so I create these methods to help. But as far as counseling goes, I mean, I still go to counseling even now.
Yeah.
I want people to know that. Because you're going to have different triggers. You're going to have different situations. Now, I will say this much. When I started speaking, I did not go to counseling.
Mm-hmm.
One of the sad part is that during that time, I had a lot of people that wanted me to share my story, that wanted me to put on this facade that I was healed.
Mm.
Nothing wrong with me anymore. And the thing was, when I was speaking from a victim point of view.
Okay.
Overcomer.
I was going to tell you, you do not speak from a victim point of view. You speak from overcomer.
Absolutely. So I actually, in 2008, I actually stopped speaking.
Okay.
And I took a break. And I went back into counseling. And then I met with this guy who is a mastermind in public speaking. But his courses were like $400 a day. And he was only here in Dallas, Texas for 3 days. So I basically waited for him in the lobby in a hotel. And I approached him and I said, I want to learn how to speak better. And he
said, sorry, my dog. Sorry about that. Keep going.
So then I said, he said, what subject are you speaking on? And I said, human trafficking. So he actually said to me, he said, if you want to be, hi.
It's Coco. Sorry.
Coco. And he said to look for 3 comedians that I look up to.
Hmm.
And so I picked Vince Morris. I picked Chris. No, I can't remember his name.
Chris Rock?
No. He's a Caucasian. He's an Irish guy.
Hmm.
He went through horrible experience in his childhood, but he makes me laugh how he tells his story.
Yeah.
I'll have to think about his last name. And the last was Steve Martin.
Okay, I love him.
And so then I told him, I said, okay, I got 3 comedians. What do you want me to do? He said, I want you to watch how they tell their story.
Mm.
I want you to own your story. You don't have to make people cry. So no, I make people laugh. I tell them, you know, this is what has happened to me. You know, I make it animated, you know, things like that. I have spoken for 15 years all over the world, from Uganda, Thailand, France, all over the United States, New York, California, Indiana, Nepal, everywhere. And so I decided I want to do more. And I feel like I can't be in all these other countries that I haven't reached out. So how can I educate people on the masses? And that's when I decided to come up with a scripted TV series. Because one day I was watching Law and Order,
mm-hmm.
and I remember Mariska Hargitay, she said that playing Olivia Benson, she received a lot of letters of survivors thanking her, you know, admiring her. And I thought to myself, why aren't we doing a story about human trafficking?
Yeah.
The other part is, I feel frustrated because we are only focusing on one type of trafficking, and that's sex trafficking. We have labor trafficking, we have organ trafficking, and we also have a baby farm that is not talked about. And the other sad part about the charity work within the human trafficking movement is that we're still segregated. So when a victim needs a place to stay, we have a shelter that says, oh, we can't take her because she's too old. And then someone else will say, well, we only take foreigners, or we only take Americans. We need to stop this segregation. We need to come together because human trafficking is a global issue. And I get people that send me stuff about Ashton Kutcher and all these other celebrities. I will say this, I love what they're doing, but I don't plan to reach out to them because they are not fighting the same cause as I am. And I'm not talking about not human trafficking. Ashton Kutcher has been a great advocate and activist for Asian girls in Asia. That's where his activist is where it's at.
Mm-hmm.
There's very rarely anyone that's fighting for American girls and boys here in the United States. Mm-hmm. Jada Pinkett wants to stay and fight for Black girls. I want to stay here and fight for American boys and girls.
Mm-hmm.
There are so many amazing survivors. Jerome Elam, he's an amazing male survivor of human trafficking. He's now an author and a public speaker, and mm-hmm. I will get you connected with him.
Great.
Jabali Smith, he's also a male survivor. He was mm-hmm. abducted from California to Mexico when he was 6 years old.
Wow.
As a sex slave.
So let me ask you, does every 40 seconds mean someone's trafficked in the world or in the United States?
It's actually not trafficked. Every 40 seconds, a child goes missing. Mm-hmm. One in every 6 child is found in human trafficking from organ, labor, sex, and being a child mule, drug mule, and also baby buying.
Mm.
According to Missing and Exploited Children, this is their stat,
along with the FBI. Today, in the United States alone, we have 2,100 children missing per day.
Wow.
That's just an estimate.
Wow. Sorry to cut you off. I would love for you to share. I know you're very passionate on educating people on how to look out for a predator, whether it be a child trafficker or someone who potentially wants to molest a child. I would love if you would give the audience some tips, you know, on how to watch out for that.
Absolutely. First off, I want to say that there was an article of a teacher, female teacher, who was sending out a text message or messenger to a student that's in the junior high, and she was being sexually explicit. The school had sent a comment back regarding that article, saying we did background checks and everything. One of the things I have to stress to you, it is important to not just look at the background check, because most predators do not get caught until they have touched probably the 100th child.
Wow.
At that time. And so when you're interviewing anyone who's going to be a caretaker, whether it's animals, whether it's children, or whether it's an elder person, basically these are people, all three of these, who fall under vulnerability. And so when someone comes in and says, hey, I want to babysit, or I want to be a child caretaker, be mindful. And if they say things like, oh, well, I love children, I want to be around them, to be around kids, help them elaborate on that love. Because if it sounds romanticized, that's a red flag. And I'm not saying that everybody that loves kids are predators. Please do not get me wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, there is a red flag when an adult wants to spend way too much time with a child than they do with their peers.
Mm.
That's, you know, and I'm not saying that they are predators, but a lot of predators do. Mm. And a lot of times we look at this adult and we think, hey, all the kids like him or her, they must be a great person, because kids can sense that. If the kid is equipped to watch out for demeanors and the behavior, then the child can detect that. But if a child has been abused, they're not going to be able to, you know, decipher what is healthy and what isn't healthy.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the other thing. And even when I was sexually abused, I knew who I didn't want to be around. But because I was already trained, not allowed to speak, guess what? I went to the child molesters. The child molesters I was growing up with, because we were always surrounded by them.
Yeah.
And there was a part of me that went to get closer to them because I wanted that attention.
Mm-hmm.
Because they used to buy me things. They used to give me candy. They used to give me a little cat. So these are also other red flags to look for. Talk to students when you're at school, if you're a parent, if you're an aunt, uncle, and talk and be a PTA member. Say, we need to have requirements at our school, from elementary, junior high, and high school, on how to be aware, because we may reach one student, and one student to me is enough.
Mm-hmm.
And now there are girls at school that are wearing colored bracelets. White means they're virgin.
Pink really? Means,
yes. And each school has different color codes, so be aware of that. High school and junior high kids are now soliciting themselves to sexual exploitation. And so whoever knows those colors, they'll buy them, they'll rent them for that hour, 30 minutes.
What? So they're wearing if they're virgin or if they're sexually active?
To let them know I'm ready to get paid.
Wow.
Yes.
Hmm.
And so when I spoke to, I'm not going to mention the school's name, but I did approach the school about the colors. One of the faculty says, well, we don't know if it's, because now kids have the consent to have sex. And I said, but you are a school building. They should not be having sex at your school.
Mm-hmm.
If it happens outside the school, you can't control that. But you have the authority to make sure these kids are safe.
Mm-hmm.
And not to allow these things happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so that's another thing to look out for. But I'm going to be every Sunday. I now created a new hashtag starting in 2019 called Cyber Safety Sundays.
Great. So
every Sunday, I'll be sharing a YouTube video of me talking. Some of them are older videos. Mm-hmm. Some of them are recent. But I'm going to be giving a course about app etiquette. I get a lot of parents that says, I don't know how to navigate this app. So the video I'm going to be working on that I'll be posting in the next 2 weeks is Snapchat. I'm
going to teach you. Oh, I need to watch that because I don't know how to do it.
No, so I'll show you the pros and cons to Snapchat.
Okay.
How people can chat with you, what you're seeing, how other people are sending new pictures to your child. These are things that you need to know. Mm-hmm. How to put security, how to contact the admin of Snapchat, mm-hmm. you know, things like that. The most important thing I want parents to know, please do not be your kid's best friend. Mm-hmm. At this moment, you need to be the parent.
Mm-hmm.
And also ask questions, not just on your child, but even your child's friends, because their friend may be chatting with someone and say, come on, I want you to meet my friend. And you're thinking, okay, because you trust your friend.
Mm-hmm.
And then she introduced you to an older guy. And you say, well, and your friend goes, come on. Well, you know, would I ever do this to you? And you think, no, so I'm going to go along. That, always remember that when that's peer pressure,
mm-hmm.
then tell them that if you respect me, then don't make me go. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the most important part. And it's hard for kids to say that. It's hard for kids to say, you know what? I can't say no to my friend. My friend needs me. She mm-hmm. wanted me to go with them. But one of the things is some kids, when they get trafficked, we're not talking about street traffickers, but we're just talking about trafficking in general. Some kids are actually trafficked in America and being taken out of the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a chance that you won't be able to come home. Mm-hmm. And that's the important thing.
Wow. No, well, thank you for sharing that. That's a lot of good education. Is it also true that a lot of molestation and rape happens with family members? Maybe even like someone like that's an uncle or a grandpa or an aunt that's watching your child. You think, we're going to be safe. You know, everything's going to be safe. And people don't realize sometimes it's the people around them, right?
Exactly. Not just family members, even church members,
mm-hmm.
even people that we know, mm-hmm. teachers, principals, coaches, mm-hmm. pastors, these are things. And one of the things I want to emphasize to every parent, please do not make your child hug and kiss.
Mm.
Because I remember growing up in the 80s, you'd see this old person, they would hug and kiss on you, and you're just standing there, and your parents pinch you, like, go and hug that lady. You'll mm-hmm. be rude. If you don't want to be rude, say, I'd rather give a high five. Can I give you a high five instead?
Yeah.
Because when I meet with my friends and their kids, and they'll say, well, give Chong a hug, I'll tell them, please don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'll look at the kid and not embarrass the mom, and they'll say, let's do a high five instead.
Mm-hmm.
And the kid actually then smiles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's important because what you're doing to that child when you say, go give them a hug, you've actually blocked their boundaries. Mm-hmm. And you block them to say no.
Mm-hmm.
They should have the right to say no. I don't care if it's grandma, mm-hmm. it's mom, auntie, it's a priest, it's a pope. I don't care.
I like that. You know, one of the things that I think would also be helpful is if parents ask their children, like, has anybody touched you like on your private parts or anything? Because I actually got molested as a child starting at age 5 by, you know, down the street, a neighborhood boy of the mm-hmm. woman that used to watch me. And I don't know if I was told not to tell or whatever, or I knew it was shameful, but I never talked about it. And I think I hear that sometimes that could be the worst part about it is not expressing. And one of the first memories I have is my mom like putting, I had chicken pox or something, and she was putting the calamine, the lotion on me. And she goes like, only mommy and daddy are allowed to like touch you here. And I remember like that moment, like being kind of confused. And I wonder like, you know, just, you know, it's not something you know, a parent wants to say to a 4-year-old or 5-year-old kid, but like maybe if they were, you know, more open and expressed, you know, that open communication and the child could communicate more. I don't know. And I know that my mom and my dad did everything they could to think I was in a safe environment, you know? And so there's no blame or anything like that. You know, it's all, you know, just, I think everything happens for a reason, part of our growth, but that's just another tip that I think would be helpful for parents. So.
Absolutely. And one of the things I definitely want to encourage parents, because I get parents that say, I'm overprotective. Don't protect your child. Equip them. Mm-hmm. That's the best way. Teach them self-defense. Teach them how to build boundaries for themselves. Mm-hmm. Teach them personal space.
Yeah.
Teach them that no means no. And mm-hmm. even with them, they have to respect somebody else's no. Please, that's the most important thing, because you can't protect them everywhere they go. You mm-hmm. can't protect them when they're at a friend's house. But you know what? You can apply the tools in the training for your child. You don't have to be elaborate about sexual abuse. You can just say, you know what? I did this with my son when he was little. He was 3 years old. And he was wearing his swimming trunks. And I said, your swimming trunks are covering what part of your body? He said, right around here. And I said, nobody, not even mommy, should touch there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you go to the doctor, the doctor has to let you know what he needs to do first.
Mm-hmm.
I tell him this. I even tell him, be careful of doctors and how they're touching you. Be careful. Make sure that I want to make sure that mommy's there. If I'm not there, grandma or auntie or nurse. But mm-hmm. never see any doctor or nurse by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't feel comfortable, what do you say? My son said, I asked for someone. Yes.
Mm.
You asked for a witness. I didn't have to talk about sex. Mm-hmm. I didn't have to talk about anything that is the anatomy, because I get parents that literally think, oh, I need to talk to my 3-year-old about sex. No, you don't. But what you can do is you can start teaching them about boundaries. Mm. This is my body. This is my personal space. No one's allowed to be in my personal space. I'm allowed to say no. Teach mm-hmm. them that first, just that basics.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
Then, you know, as they get older, then you can talk further.
That's really great. Thank you for sharing that, Chong.
Okay.
You know, I would like to, you know, we were talking the other day and I was asking you about your healing and one of the ways to move forward when, you know, you're angry at someone, but you want to forgive. And you shared with me a forgiveness exercise that really helped you. And I would love for you to share it with everyone watching.
Absolutely. For a long time, I could not stand the word forgive. It was like a scratch on a chalkboard.
Mm-hmm.
When I would hear people say, you need to forgive, I'm like, no, 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 no. And so I had a therapist that was teaching me. And she said to me, she said, write a list of people you can't forgive. Then on another sheet of paper, she wanted me to write a prayer. And so for those who are not Christians, you can call it a chant, a meditation. Mm-hmm. So it's called, I'm letting you go so I can be me. I'm letting you go so I can be free. I'm mm-hmm. breaking the chains that shackles you and me to give me the wings to fly.
Mm-hmm.
And just keep, you know, saying that every single day, even if it sounds crazy in the first couple of times, but keep writing their name while you're writing the chant. Write their name or write their chant. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say, let's say there's a guy named Derek. Mm-hmm. That really hurt me. So I'll say, I'm letting you go, Derek,
mm-hmm.
so I can be free. I'm letting you go, Derek, so I can be me. Mm-hmm. I'm breaking the chains that shackles you and me so I can have the wings to fly. Oh. So I replace it with their names. And I get used to it until it's no longer becoming an emotional burden. Because I'm a true believer that when we hold on to things, then it actually turns into emotional cancer.
Mm-hmm.
We start
do you think it could actually cause a physical cancer or disease in the body?
Mm-hmm. High blood pressure, anxiety, migraine headaches, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so when people ask me, how are you smiling today? And I look at them and I say, well, one, I wasn't trafficked yesterday. And then two,
good point.
I have every right to smile.
You do. Oh, you make me smile.
Thank you.
Well, before we wrap up, I know you're passionate about a nonprofit called Alert Ministries, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So would you tell us a little bit about them and
absolutely.
Why our viewers should support them?
Absolutely. March 25th, Alert Ministry is going to be launching their stage play about Humber. What's that one with the pinwheel? Rumpelstiltskin.
Okay.
Rumpelstiltskin. I was thinking of Hunchback in Notre Dame at the same time. And I was like, wait, that didn't sound. Rumpelstiltskin. And then I'm going to be on the panel with another nonprofit, two amazing nonprofits that's also going to be on the panel with me. But right now, what Alert Ministry does, and this is close to my heart, Alert Ministry caters and serves to the boys and girls in the juvenile detention center. Okay. These are kids who have been trafficked, but are overlooked as being rebellion, troublemakers, and they're not. They're victims. They need to be loved. And they pray with them. They serve them Christmas and Thanksgiving dinners for them. They make them, they tell them that they're loved by God. It's mm-hmm. a Christian ministry. They are amazing, but they don't Bible thump. And Christine McKenzie is a really good friend of mine. She's a founder. Mm-hmm. I would love for her to be on your show sometime.
Oh, yeah, me too.
She's also a survivor of sexual abuse.
Okay.
And so she is amazing. And we've been friends since 2011, mm-hmm. me and Christina. And, but yeah, if you look up Alert Ministries, and I've even posted about their plan on my Facebook page.
Okay.
People can follow me at Chong Kim on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. I am Chong Kim.
Okay. So it's Chong Kim, correct?
Yeah. Chong Kim. Before I go, I want to let everyone know I'm coming out with a scripted TV series called Every 40 Seconds mm-hmm. because we want to apply it to the stats of the missing children. Mm-hmm. And it's actually about a female survivor who teaches the FBI how to think like a trafficker. Mm-hmm. So they can, and I've written about 80 synopses.
Wow.
80 episodes.
Woo! You go, girl.
Yes. And so we're going to be shooting it all over the United States and even globally. I mm-hmm. even have friends in the UK that wants me to write the Every 40 Seconds UK version. And
wow.
We've got one that's an Asia version. Because we need to come together and unify and to fight human trafficking.
That's just beautiful. Well, I wish you all the best with that project, and I'm excited to be involved. And
absolutely,
and you talked about you coming to LA to do a human trafficking event, and I would love for Jenerosity Foundation to collaborate with you. Just thank you for sharing your heart and. Being able to heal yourself to be able to give back like you are. It's
absolutely.
You are an overcoming trendsetter.
Yes.
That's beautiful. Well, thank you so much. And let's keep in touch for sure. So
absolutely.
All right. You have a great night.
You too.
Okay. Bye. All right, everybody, that was wonderful. Chong Kim, check her out at iamchongkim.com on Instagram and Facebook. That was a beautiful story of inspiration. And speaking of forgiveness, I had a gentleman reach out to me last week on Facebook, and he said, I want to share my story of forgiveness, of generosity on the Jenerosity Show. And I said, okay, cool, what is it? And he sent me an article, and it was on forgiveness. And I had never really thought of forgiveness as being generous, but I realized after reading his story and thought and prayer that forgiveness is one of the most generous things that you can do. And why this man is so inspirational is that he actually forgave his mother's killer. She was brutally murdered, and because of his love for Jesus and walking that life of forgiveness, he went on stand and forgave the killers. So I'm excited to have Xander Chasen on the show. He'll be on in a couple weeks. The show is going to be every Friday at 5 p.m. And I'm calling it the Holy Spirit Happy Hour. And one of the things is Xander and I talked on the phone last Sunday, and he asked if he could pray for me. And during the prayer, he had a revelation. And the revelation was that the J in generosity actually stands for Jesus. And I know that is so true. It rang so beautifully in my heart. And, you know, Jesus, because Jesus was the most generous person to ever walk the earth, he gave his life for us. And every day I tried to be more and more like him and ask him to shape me into him. So I wanted to give everyone an update. The J in generosity doesn't actually stand for Jennifer. It stands for Jesus. And I'm excited to have him on the show here soon. So thank you, everybody, for watching. Thank you, Chong. You are an inspiration. And I just encourage everyone to go out and be generous. Have a beautiful weekend. Bye.